The result of the latest Pulse Asia survey on the ratings of the country's top leaders, as well as voter preference for the 2025 senatorial and 2028 presidential polls. Political analyst Professor Edmund Tayo now joins us to discuss these. Professor Tayo is the president and CEO of Political Economic Elemental Researchers and Strategists, or PEERS, a newly formed group. What's this group all about? Before we continue, this is new. I've always introduced you as something else, but tell us a little bit about PEERS.
Well, rather very shortly, Carmina, thanks for asking that. Many of us have been working on a lot of things, research, policy work, and also consulting with the political leaders, private enterprises, and so on, doing political and economic analysis. We thought that we might consider coming together and forming one single team. So if you need the political analysis, if you need analysis of how public discussion is going on as far as your work is concerned, how the public has been responding, if you want to understand economic issues, inflation, employment, and so on and so forth, the group can provide you with everything. We also have a group of lawyers who have very much experience in the kind of work that we do.
Very interesting. And this is independent of any political agenda of any politician.
Actually, it took some time for us to organize ourselves, Carmina. It took us so many years, precisely because we don't want anyone to be, funding it, bankrolling it. That will prevent us from being really independent. So what we're going to do once it's fully operational is that we'll be able really now to inform the public more and hopefully give a dent to those fake news that we're experiencing now.
Well, yeah, that's our main job as well. But one last question on PEERS before we go on to the topic today, because this is very interesting to me. So PEERS organized already when it comes to elections, for example, that's imminent, 2025, 2028. Is your group going to be responsible for putting a badge on, let's say, policies that this or that politician is going to further during the campaign trail, and if and when that politician wins?
There are communications with some political leaders wanting to work with us. But I have to be frank with you, Carmina, we'll be quite picky because we'd like to also advocate for some of the, sabi mo nga, you know me already, I've been advocating for decentralization, for system change, and so on and so forth. It's difficult to work with a political figure. Mm-hmm. Kumbaga, difficult to market a product that you don't believe in. So we have to come to an understanding before peers can actually work with them. So it's not just the political leaders, it can also be private enterprises. I myself, for example, worked with an international firm before doing their PR work. So, it depends, Carmina, kasi, we have to be quite picky because the members of PEERS, or the PEERS, actually have their names as their main capital, really. Well, we're still raising funds for the company itself, but individually, our main capital is our name.
I have to tell you, Professor, that this is more interesting than the topic that we're about to discuss today. But let's move on with this. I have to book you another time, right, to talk about this and what is needed in terms of policy changes and all that. First of all, performance and trust ratings of the country's top officials. What does this snapshot tell you, Professor?
Well, it's good really that we're doing a periodic assessment of how our political leaders have been performing. There's so much more to do, so much more to have, basically, as far as measuring public satisfaction. As it is right now, of course, as you can see, the numbers reflect what issues come out in the news. What issues have become topic, no, for discussion, whether between friends and associates, but even informal discussion. Mm-hmm. So obviously, of course, this is a reflection of how the people's perception is. So the word there is perception as far as the key issues are concerned. So there's a need to deepen this perception into more of understanding.
Yeah, but perception as well means power.
Exactly. So the more we just cultivate this perception and not deepening understanding, the more it becomes subject only to the control of interested parties, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, there will be you mentioned it yourself. That's why I'm inclined to think. I'm not inclined to think, but I'm a firm believer of what the ANC does and the many other news organizations that's actually organized only for news, no, and public opinion. Because ito yung kailangan natin. Many of what we see on TV is simply entertainment, and that's it. So at most, when we talk about issues, it's just on the surface. Yeah.
Even if this is just on the surface, and there's got to be a deeper understanding to these numbers. I mean, you're no stranger to this. You've seen thousands of numbers in your career. But going back to the president and the vice president, the numbers that we're looking at right now, is this where they want to be at this point in their terms?
If I were them, and I'd like to, as much as possible, remain popular, no? That's why I emphasize on the perception thing, because if I were the political figure, it's still to my advantage that the public responds more on what's available for them, no? Whether the kind of information that they can munch on or that can percolate, no? Which is not much. So that means it is still to their advantage. So if the numbers are not very good for the political leaders, then that means they have not been able really make the most out of this perception, not that we've been talking about at the outset.
Mm. Which brings me to my next question. These numbers, not necessarily good, not necessarily bad, but they can do something with this.
Yep.
So on the part of the president, based on the issues now, and also on the part of the vice president, what sway can they have on certain political issues or on certain social issues as well, given these numbers? Because these numbers still have a lot of sway in them.
Yep.
Go ahead.
Definitely. In other words, there's so much room for improvement. Basically, that's how I understand your point, no? I don't know if it's a strategy or it's an unwritten rule as far as political leaders are concerned. But if you notice, Carmina, our political leaders have not been really that communicative, so to speak. It's another way of saying they've not been saying so much. Mm. On the part of the vice president, for example, it would be best really if she can speak more of her position as far as foreign relations are concerned or foreign policy is concerned. I've noticed that in the news or in the public discussions, there's not much pronouncements, no, in this regard. Alam mo kasi, the tendency for political leaders is not to say so much, especially at a certain point in time, in a certain point in the political period, no, precisely because they want to be sure, no, as to how the public is going to respond. Pero it can be interpreted either way, Carmina. Pwedeng yung pagiging tahimik mo is a measure or is an indication that you don't know much, or that you're being sigurista, or you're making sure that you can only say something that will benefit you. On the part of the president, on the other hand, of course, again, there are some interviews that I've seen, no, that while it's been to his advantage when it comes to the issue of the West Philippine Sea, there was this international interview. Mm-hmm. No, he was being asked how likely is a shooting incident going to happen in the West Philippine Sea? And the answer has not been that quite forthcoming. Mm-hmm. So, communication, and I'm sure you will agree, is very much, you know, out of the 100% of what you do as a political figure, that would make up probably 80, even 90%. Mm. So, if you're not
isn't that expecting? But sorry to cut you there, Professor, but isn't that expecting too much from these two, considering that that's how they campaigned and that's how they won? Very measured, didn't really exactly communicated only the way they wanted to communicate. Your thoughts on that?
Well, that's why, as I've said, no, it has to work both ways. That's why there has to be a group that will really be doing something that will considerably, you know, deepen people's understanding, because it is right now what's just being presented, you know, is just simple, plain and simple fodder for perception. No, so kaya nga, what I'm saying is you might want to make the most out of this prevailing situation. Perception pa nga lang yan. So if you translate it into something simpler, something that you know, the public can easily munch on, the problem is you want to get brownie points at the expense of other people. That's also another way that's negative campaigning. But what is more stable when it comes to a political figure is to say something that's more substantive, that will be easily understood by the people, so that you will be identified really as this personality, you know, that is quite forward, quite clear when it comes to a particular issue. So yun yung hindi explore kasi.
Oo. At yun din nga siguro yung rason kung bakit tinalaga yung grupo ninyo. Because we have, you know, I mean, the history of this country, voters have placed leaders based on just perception, not really the true value of the leader.
Exactly. That's why kailangan magtulungan talaga dito, Carmina. Actually, you know, the way I've been seeing public discussions, no, and we can get more out of the so-called analyst, mm-hmm. not just an analyst, but we can get as much number of experts really who are really experts. No, I've seen so many interviews where, you know, the resource person would like to appear to be expert of practically everything. No, pag tinanong mo, may sagot siya palagi. Eh, pwede namang sabihin mo hindi mo lang yung issue, and I can get back to you.
I guess hindi siya miyembro ng peers. Hindi niyo sinama. Wait a minute. Let's go back to the discussion here. So these numbers that we're looking at, right, are the president and the vice president. You know, as I said a while ago, this is not necessarily low, not necessarily bad, not necessarily good as well. It's substantial still. Do you think that it's still substantial? And if it is, where could they possibly bring these numbers to benefit not their popularity, not how they're perceived by the people, but benefit the country, Professor?
As you've said, it's not really low, it's not really high, you know. So it's still in the positive level. I'm sure, of course, remember a time when, you know, the sitting president had a negative rating, and that's really quite something, you know. If you're the president and the vice president, you want to improve these numbers instead of further going down. No, first. And so that's why I said at the outset, mas maganda if they will be more forthcoming in their messages, no, in their communications to the public. You know, the president, because he's president, there's so much that is expected of him. And the vice president, because she's perceived to be, even if, let's say, for the sake of argument, she says that she's not interested in running, she has not given thought to being president. But anyone and everyone who's been vice president before has been already, considered as a presidential timber, hence to be able to communicate as a presidential timber. Mm. So, sa madali, pareho sila na there's so much expectation that has to be met. So what will it be good for the public? Yun na nga, makakabuti ito sa publiko kasi the moment they are able to communicate something that's more concrete, then definitely that is something that the public can already hold them accountable.
And these numbers should make them comfortable.
Exactly. Exactly. Kaya nga, yun nga, it goes both ways, Carmina. Yun yung hindi natin maintindihan sa klase ng politika natin. Gusto mong maging sigurista as a political figure, that's fine. Pero yung magiging sigurista without you realizing it is also the same as being quite upfront, no, when it comes to what you have in mind, no, particularly those pressing issues. Ano ba yung mga pressing issues natin? Apart from the West Philippine Sea, of course, yung poverty ever since eh, talagang issue yan, no? Pinag-uusap charter change, anong position mo diyan? Eh ang problema dahil naniniguro ka eh ang tendency mo magbibigay ka ng isang very vague response.
But on the flip side,
mamimili ka ng issue na tatayuan mo talaga.
On the flip side, kasi ang tinitingnan siguro nila at saka ng mga handlers is how to preserve the numbers, right? But on the flip side, you should be able to see these numbers as a solid foundation that people are listening to you, that people are trusting you. Enough for you to be comfortable already to say what you really want if you haven't done. So, ang problema, baka walang masabi talaga.
Ang problema siguro dyan, Carmina, ang tinitingnan lang nila, ang sineservey palagi, eh yun ngang tinatawag na popularity. Dapat tinitingnan din ng mga tao nila, ng mga eksperto that's working with them, what issues are really very, not only interesting, but what are the issues that matter to the people, no? And what's the understanding of the people as far as 1, 2, 3 issues are concerned? What's their position in these issues? Kasi pag hindi mo alam kung anong pulso ng tao dito sa mga issue, eh talagang kahit na may alam ka, Carmina, you won't be in a position to craft the right communication, the right strategy for the public to notice you, for the public to see more of you. So it has both ways. You have to measure that. No? Ang problema, hindi naman tinitingnan masyado itong issue. Ngayon, sasabihin nila, paano kung ayaw ng tao sa posisyon na naiisip namin na maganda? Then, that becomes all the more, no? All the more a job for you. The more that you should be able to communicate to the public that, hey, mali yung iniisip ninyo, no? The majority might be able to learn more from you, considering that the little that they know with the issue makes them decide on the issue in a way that for you as the one making the decisions, the crucial decisions, is the right way to go. Explain mo sa tao kung bakit ganito dapat yung magiging posisyon natin.
All right, from the present, Professor Tayo, and we're running out of time and I want to go through these questions. From the present, let's go to the imminent. We're talking about the 2025 senatorial elections. This list that we're about to show our viewers, I'm sure you've seen it as well. What does this tell you? What is the story here? What is fueling this perception that these are, if it were to be held today, that these are the deserving winners? Go ahead.
I'm going to comment on the assumption that this is a benchmark, which means to my mind, any survey that is done at this juncture, which is more than a year away from the midterm elections, is an indication of, or at least the significance of which is, if you're a candidate, it tells you where you are now. No, asan ka ngayon, anong numbers mo? But the more important thing for them to understand is why is it that they are in that particular number or that particular position? Perhaps they might want to ask those who conducted the survey, saan area ba yung mga respondents, saan, in other words, they have to look at the fine print, no? Not just the overall numbers. We have to take note, Carmina, also that the senatorial elections is a unique part of our election. Unique because it's you know, in the electoral system, it's called multi-member districts. That means you're electing not one, no, not two, but multiple candidates, no, for the position. So ibang iba yan doon sa presidential election. Kaya minsan hindi ko naiintindihan bakit ang aga-aga pa may presidential survey na. Eh dapat after the midterm elections, more or less kung gumawa ng benchmark. So now, going through all this, the reason why I'm emphasizing it's a benchmark is because it mainly reflects the just, no, the plain and simple popularity. Pag tinignan mo yung mga pangalan dyan, yan yung mga kilala na talaga ng mga tao. No? So, kumbaga, nire-reflect niya na these are the so-called the preferred candidates for now, kasi hindi pa dumaan dun sa proseso at hindi pa na-communicate masyado sa mga tao kung ano ang hanapin nila.
Okay, so, in the absence of that though, Professor, I need to ask you, and this is going to tie up to what you and I were talking about a while ago, ushering a new kind of discourse, ushering a new kind of politics here in the country. When you look at that list, do you think that it's more of the same, or do you think that this is ushering a new kind of politics in the country? What are your thoughts?
Parang hindi na kailangan pag-usapan yung Carmina. It's more of the same. I mean, to be honest with you, we've been seeing different names. I have a new article in your website now, mm-hmm. and I'm trying to explain there that you know, the voters, to be fair with the voters, you know that I've always been saying there's no such thing as bobotante. The people actually have always been thinking, except that the basis for their thinking has always been quite limited. And so you really have to feed them enough information to have enough basis for them to make decisions. But having said that, yun na nga, kulang pa din kasi yung mga choices natin. In other words, we're limited to choosing from the same source, from the same people, from the same background. So, yun na nga. So, brings us back to what we were talking about earlier, no? We're having more and more political leaders who will speak about something that you really cannot decide whether it's substantive or it's something categorical when it comes to issues. So it becomes incumbent on us really to get the people more involved, no, and allow them more basis, allow them more information so that they can make better decisions.
Professor, it may be the same names, you're right, the same limited source as you pointed out, but some of the names falling way behind where they want to be at this point. If it were a benchmark being set right now, we're talking about members of the Liberal Party, for example, falling way behind. What does that tell you, Professor?
You know, Carmina, since the election of the former President Duterte, the name of the Liberal Party has been significantly reduced, so to speak. You know, masyadong malalim yung naging epekto sa Liberal Party. The Liberal Party used to be one of the most organized, structured political party, but because of so much expectation from the Liberal Party from the time that democracy was supposedly restored to the country in the election of Dasan, tapos hindi naka-deliver, doon medyo nagkaroon ng doubt, no, on the part of the public. It will require someone who can really convince the public that the Liberal Party is a lot more than what happened before. So sana makakita sila ng isang political figure na yon can change, no, the character, the overall character of the political party.
Well, as you said, and as we've been repeating, this is merely a perception, a snapshot of what is happening right now. From here onwards, from here onwards, do you see the picture changing? Do you see the trajectory changing?
Yes, very much, Carmina. Again, if I may emphasize, the senatorial elections, the way we elect senators is the single different kind of elections that we have overall, no, when we elect the president, vice president, members of Congress, and so on, sila lang yung multi-member. Sa madalit sabi, mas maraming space, so to speak, both for improvement and mistake. Now, having said, if you remember, now I cannot forget this incident. No, I mean the case as far as senatorial elections is concerned. I remember quite clearly. I think that was 2013. I'm not sure. The first time that Senator Grace Poe ran for the Senate, no, all surveys have been pointing her to land between rank 8 to 12. Pero there were some surveys that were not much publicized, no? I think it was done by a network that pegged her as the number one, no? At nag-number one nga si Senator Grace Poe. Mahirap kasi i-predict yung senatorial elections kasi nga marami yung binoboto mo.
Okay.
Pero doon, very fluid din siya. So pwedeng ka sa napakataas na bigla kang magiging number one, or pwedeng nandun ka naman sa number one tapos biglang babagsak.
Would you say that there's going to be some kind of fluidity as well when you talk about the presidential preference survey results? You have Raffy Tulfo there, followed by Sara Duterte, and then Lenny Robredo, 35-34, and then 11. What do you make of this snapshot?
Alam mo, I don't want to be malicious there, Carmina, but dalawang bagay. Sino ang nagpa-survey niyan? Kung sila ang nagpa-survey niyan, I'm being a consultant speaking now, hindi pa tama na pinapublicize ninyo yung result kasi napakaaga. It will only invite so much unwanted attention on your part that you are gunning for a higher position, no, come next election. Kung hindi naman sila nagpa-survey niyan, merong motibo din, no, kung bakit pinapa-survey. Kasi nga as I'm trying to say, again, if you remember the case of former Vice President Jojo Binay, no? Ang hirap nung napakaaga pa lang nandyan ka na eh. Kasi so many things can still happen. Now, it could be on the plus side if you are going to be really substantive. Substantive really, that fine, you don't mind being in the limelight, but just make sure that you will really be able to use the limelight to your advantage. Pero kasi pag nasa limelight ka, isang mali mo lang, tapos yan.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Professor Edmond Tayo, the President and CEO of Political Economic Elemental Researchers and Strategists, or PEERS. I'm pretty sure I'll be talking to you again and any one of your peers soon enough. Thank you so much for joining us today. Really appreciate all your insights.
Thank you.
Take care.